My name is Rebecca Jones, and I'm the Houston area representative of the Schiller Institute. I'm pleased to bring you this, the latest in what has been a series of concerts sponsored in the Houston area by the Schiller Institute. Last October, the Schiller Institute brought to Houston an international campaign that had been launched to lower tuning back to the tuning preferred by Mozart, Beethoven, Verdi, and the great classical composers, C equals 256 or A equals 430. We had a historic concert. Many of Houston's finest artists participated, and we established that the lower tuning does indeed enable the singers to bring people music as it was intended by the composer. This concert will be performed by Doug Yates, a Houston area baritone who just spent the last year singing with the National Opera Company out of Raleigh, North Carolina. He's a very talented musician and especially loves the great German and classical Lieder repertoire. Unfortunately, we will not be bringing you this concert at the lower tuning. However, Doug will demonstrate what the superiority of the lower tuning, what the lower tuning does by taking two songs as examples and using an electronic keyboard. He will show you the difference between the higher and the lower pitch. I'd just like to say that a young artist like Doug has to start his career by singing opera, and this is something that the Schiller Institute finds very unfortunate, because in the songs that you'll hear Doug sing tonight, you really hear the gems of the great classical vocal repertoire, and I'm sure you will enjoy Doug's performance of them. Thank you.
Thank you. Rüßlein auf der Heide, Rüßlein wird now for a very, I think, an interesting observation. We're going to do these a demonstration with one of Faure's, one of his most beloved songs, "En Sourdine." I think it's very interesting that what you'll note is how even during Faure's time, the pitch was substantially lower than it is today. There is a specific vocal production that they have in the French school, which is called the voix mixte, which I'm sure a lot of the singers will be familiar with. It's production that is purely in the head voice. The people here in the States call it a falsetto. There's a big rivalry as to whether you want to call it falsetto or voix mixte, which sounds a little more fancy, I guess. But as far as this demonstration goes, being a student of Suzet's, Mr. Suzet, I think that explaining it in the voix mixte is acceptable. What we'll do for you, the very final phrase of this song has got it's got a line that says "Le Rossignol chantera," and the chantera is on an E flat, and in the score it's more triple pianissimo, which is as a baritone that sits right on this little place that we need to get over into the higher register of our voice, the head voice, and in the bel canto production that is slightly different because we get over into a brighter sound that turns over into the highest part of our mechanism. And in the French production, it's quite the opposite. It would be more of a flute-like sound. I think the best way to describe it would be a woman's break from her chest voice and her middle voice into her real head, where you hear something like, right? So that's the best way to describe the use of the voix mixte. So what I'm going to do for you is I'll sing it once as it's written at the higher key, so you can get an idea of what the French actually perceive as a tone. And then we'll do it a few different ways. Just a few, I promise. That's as pure as I can make it, which is, like I said, this big school of thought as to whether it's falsetto or voix mixte. Now what I'd like to do for you is do it in what would be a more Italian production, which would be less of that part of the head voice, but more of the upper middle and what the Italians call that ringing, biting, pinging Italian octave. So I'll do it now with a little more of that sound in it, so you can hear the difference. The triple pianissimo up there on an E flat is, like I said, it's right on baritone's turning position. Actually, a baritone starts getting into that mechanism at about B flat and B natural middle C in order to really prepare the extreme height of the voice, which you'll hear later in a Brahms song. But now what we'll do is we're going to go to this keyboard we have that's the lower pitch, and I want to show you the difference that the effects it makes in the French production of the voix mixte. It brings it a little lower and gives it a sound that I think is more akin to a voice soprano. It gives it a more haunting resonance, which may be very well what Faure was looking for at the time. And also, what you'll hear, to do it more in an Italianate production with a little more of the upper middle and the Italian head voice, I think you'll hear that it's more accessible. It's even in, as the Italians would do it, it is more accessible to do things like start it with the mezzo forte and diminuendo to be pianissimo, which would be a lovely effect. But at this key, it's almost next to impossible, unless you're, you know, really pretty wonderful, and maybe we'll do that for you later. I've had a very long day, okay. Thank you. let's do it at the same pitch with a more Italian production as far as the top is concerned. And I think you there's a much greater ease through that position because you're just below all of these terrible lifts, passages, breaks, whatever you've been taught that they are. Kevin. Is that we can start that at a mezzo piano, almost a mezzo forte, and you'll spin the sound down with a real which is quite easy at this pitch. At this pitch, you'll find it's not quite so easy. Would you play for me an E flat on this piano? If you can move it. In this case, a laryngeal adjustment here, excuse me. At this pitch, God willing, I could still do it, but if not, you'll see the problems that it presents. we'll just assume you did that. Now again, play for me guys in the lower pitch on the E flat. Now the vomit, the sound you hear, it's very difficult to hear to distinguish the differences in colors there. At the lower pitch, to get this fluty head tone, which the French are infamous for doing, and which I've been schooled in and out, the production would be something like this. One more time, please. It sounds like it's almost in an empty space. You'll feel it's low, so you get a little more ethereal color to the sound. Now do a little step higher, and what happens is that you'll find that a little more of the upper range comes in, and it becomes more difficult to create that misterioso, that melancholique, the sound that the French like. One more time, sorry. That has a little more resonance to it, has a little more turn in it, as opposed to one more time. Song. And now let's do the whole song at this pitch. It can be very confusing trying to jostle your brain back and forth. And oh, by the way, Mr. Suze sends his regrets. He would have liked to have been here. He unfortunately is lounging in the south of France at his villa, the south of France, and his villa de Bastion. And he wishes us all the best and gung-ho and all that kind of thing. Or as he would say, gung-ho. Thank you. As you can see on the program, there's some notes with this particular song. I have a friend of mine who's here, who's visiting, who is an A&M student, who saw me do it the first time, and he didn't realize there were two characters involved. And so here I have one Mrs. Masfield character going, let me in, and she's going, no, stay away, and it's kind of silly. So I would tell, please read the translation as we do this one, since you think I'm absolutely crazy. Singer's purgatory, this song can be, because Brahms did a wonderful thing by writing this lovely, lovely chromatic line moving up to an E flat, and he has this huge phrase mark over the top of it. It's about 8 bars long, and he says not to breathe. I've heard a dozen or so younger singers do it, and you see their larynx crawl up to their eyeballs, and you see this panic look, and they start coming down, and sweat burst forth. It's very difficult, particularly now at the higher pitch. You're having to really turn over to the top of that vowel, and so you had to change the color of the vowel, and you can't maintain the richness and the quality of the voice all the way up. Let's do it at the high key for them once and let them hear the adjustment. This thing happens twice, not just once, but twice. And then after he does it the second time, he makes you go a little bit higher. And it's, it's one of the first songs that I heard that I thought was the most beautiful thing I ever heard. And I started to sing it, and I cursed the day I saw it. But I had Dalton Baldwin, one of Mr. Suzette's, one of his only accompanists, worked with him. He heard me do this, and I took a breath. He goes, "Und die einsame Tränerin," and he goes, "If you're gonna sing the song, you can't breathe." Mm-hmm. And I had done this. I had never been able to do it. And there's Dalton Baldwin standing here at this piano, and I'm sitting here like this, going, "Oh my God!" I was like a junior in college, and he says, "Don't breathe." Okay. So I just took a big breath, and I did it without a breath. And ever since then, I've been doing it without a breath. We'll see if we can not maintain the tradition. Okay, now this is this terrible phrase at the higher pitch. I mean, what he's having. Turn it over to a, almost a trena, as opposed to which at the lower pitch, if you'll be so kind as to demonstrate for us, at the lower pitch we have the luxury of being down at a point of the voice where we don't have to get over the top like that, and so we can carry up a little more richness in the voice, and it's much easier, and it's I think a little more pleasing to the ear because you don't hear a change in color from the lower part of the voice to the higher, particularly. Because you hear us sinking back down into the baritones, you know, our safety zone, you know, middle C to middle C. And so now at this pitch, I think you'll be able to hear that you can get over the top much easier. There's no modification at all, actually. that makes this song particularly difficult is that standard tradition now in the performance of this song is to do this line moving up with no crescendo until you get to trena, and you're up there as pianissimo, hopefully, and then you crescendo out of that down back into the lower part. And at the higher key, that becomes a little testy. At the lower key, you'll find that you just get a little more space, a little more richness in the voice, and you see less caution in the face of the singer, because it's like, oh my God, here we go. So anyway, thanks, Kevin. Now we'll do it at the higher pitch. It's like, when you start doing it with the lower pitch, you find all these things that are so much easier. You find yourself not worrying about things. You get it in this key, and it's like, oh my God. So let's try it.
Streiche bringt und sein
like to include that in a ROM set. About a year or two ago, I first put it in, and this little German lady, she was about 70, she came up to me in tears, and she goes, my grandma was saying that to me, and it just hit me, and so it stays.